presidential lecture series at Medgar Evers College of the City University of New York. Dr. Edison O. Jackson, President.
To Professor Barton, to the class of 2001 and beyond, to the faculty, administration, and staff, welcome to the Presidential Lecture Series, which is in honor of a fallen comrade, Dr. Betty Shabazz. As I thought about what could I say to a freshman class that has had approximately 3 weeks enjoying the instruction here at Medgar Evers College, also being challenged in ways perhaps that they have never been challenged in their lives. The central thought then that I would like to speak to this evening is pressing on. And the byline is, there ain't no stopping you now.
It's a wake-up call. And I want you then to look at what it means to learn from each other. Look at what it means, because you know that I was proud to meet the student government president. I was glad to meet the young woman, articulate and smooth and charismatic, who gave the invocation. And I'm glad to shake your hand and welcome your warm embrace, because I recognize how important you are. I recognize that you are the leadership. And you know that leaders, when asked across the college and university circuit of America, when they were asked, what does it take to lead? They didn't talk about dress for success, because they understood that if you're wearing it, it's not an asset. If you're driving it, it's not an asset. You have to own it, or operate it, or copyright it for it to be an asset. They understood that it's not the outside that needs to be dressed up, it's the inside. And they knew that it's the house of mind that knows more. And they understood clearly that it's risk-taking and leadership and commitment and staying on the cutting edge, early arrivals and late departures. They understood that in any group, there are always going to be some who will lead, and then some will follow, and then there'll be a whole slew of folk who simply don't want to get involved in the process. In other words, there are those who will make things happen and those who will watch things happen. And then there are a whole slew of folk who wonder, what in the world has happened? The other day I saw a bumper sticker and it was blank, which suggested to me they didn't want to be involved in anything. So leadership is not personality, it's performance. And it's more desirable to complain than it is to act upon it. So I'm not sure exactly how it is that you come into this ballroom, this beautiful auditorium for this lecture series, and you flick a switch and the lights come on. I don't know exactly how that works. I know it's a solar and heat that propels the light, but I'm not sure exactly how it works. But even though I'm not sure exactly how it works, I can tell you one thing: you won't come in here and find me sitting in the dark. And that's what matriculation means. You won't be sitting in the dark, because you will be excellent in your studies. You will have your mind on the possible, and you will have the understanding from within that power comes from within.
Thank you very much. It's an honor to be here and appear before you on Black Solidarity Day. President Jackson and distinguished members of the Medgar Evers faculty and staff, and freshmen, I guess. Yesterday, Al Van and I were at a rally where we're getting the troops all revved up for Tuesday, and we both lamented the fact that despite the fact that the place was packed, very few people your age was there, people slightly older than you, very few young people were there. We were lamenting the fact that here we are in a critical battle, pivotal point in our history, where much of the things that we fought so hard for over the last 50 years to gain are being taken away. You know, they're trying to roll back the clock. And we look around us and we don't see the generation that has to take over and resist these rollbacks and fight to carry us forward. So I welcome today's opportunity. You know, I think I would like to make a plea that I be invited back often. Any opportunity to address young people, to address students, to address the leaders of tomorrow is a welcome one, and it's an investment that I think would be pay big dividends. I hope that you understand how important you are. I hope that you understand that no matter what you're majoring in, what you intend to do, you are automatically a candidate for leadership. That there are very few people in America, despite the fact that we have a lot of colleges and universities, the percentage of people who go on to higher education, who go to college, is still a small percentage. Across the whole world, the number of people who go to college is a very tiny percentage of all the people in the world. So those who have the opportunity to gain a higher education and more knowledge and so forth, automatically the call is there. Civilization as a whole needs you for leadership. The nation needs you for leadership. Thank you.
Thank you, Brother Provost. You know, my sisters and brothers, when I walked into this building today with my husband, I heard words ringing in my ears that I first heard from one of the Caribbeans and the world's truly great men of letters, Jamaica's Andrew Salkey, who used a phrase that I felt very, very deeply as I walked into Medgar Evers College. Borrowing from Andrew, I will tell you, being here, it make me feel more like my natural self. And I want you to know that when Brother Alexander Barton first called in the interest of the Brother President Jackson to ask if I would come to be a part of this series, my immediate reaction was, I'm on sabbatical, check with me later. And then he explained why I would have no choice but to be here today. It's not because it's the president's lecture series. I respect presidents. They have their place in the world. It's not even because this is a part of the fresh woman and fresh men's responsibility. And I do respect you in your first year of this extraordinary process called getting a college education. I am here because of unbelievably deep love and respect for my sister, Shiro, Dr. Betty Shabazz. How could I not be here in a series that is dedicated to the memory of not just a professor, a beloved professor, a colleague for many of you, a mighty, mighty soldier in what I would call the war against inequality and injustice, a righteous, righteous woman. The tragedy of her death cannot be erased, either from our minds or from our hearts. But the Betty Shabazz that I knew and loved would not have us dwell on how she died. She would insist that we focus on what she struggled for while she was on Earth. And so, dear sisters and brothers who are students of this exceptional place, in the spirit of Betty Shabazz, I have come to charge you. If you're not in it, you need to get in the struggle.
I want to speak to you on this subject. Let's see if we can keep it in mind. I don't want to stray from it. The subject is the future is now. The future is now. This subject comes to me when I think about a book that I read as a graduate student called Democracy in America. The book was written by a man named Alexis de Tocqueville. Alexis de Tocqueville. He was a Frenchman who came over here in the 1800s to study America's prisons. He was going to be the director of prisons in France, and he came to America to see how we did it over here. But when he got here, he was more attracted to the topic of black people than he was to the topic of prisons. And de Tocqueville went all over the Southland looking into the faces of the slaves and asking himself the question, what on earth is going to happen to them when once they're set free? De Tocqueville saw 4 million slaves all over Alabama, Mississippi, Virginia, and North Carolina. And in his mind, as a visitor from France, he said to himself, no way. These people will never make it in America. So he wrote his book, Democracy in America. He made 3 predictions in that book. 1 prediction was that America and Russia would become the 2 great world powers, and that prediction came true. He made another prediction that we would have to be concerned about what he called the tyranny of the majority. He meant by that there would come a time in America when certain ideas would just flood the whole country that would destroy our freedoms because the majority would hold these ideas and impose them on the rest of us. He said we had certain constitutional rights to protect us from this. But he said there's a big danger that those rights will not be sufficient. So he said America will have to watch out for this, the tyranny of the majority. That is when the majority can have a wrong idea and impose it on the rest of us. Now, the future that Mr. de Tocqueville was talking about is right now. We're living in that future right now. I wish I could wake him up. Do you wish you could wake him up? I wish I could wake him up. Wake up, de Tocqueville, baby. I want to talk to you. I'd like to say, Mr. de Tocqueville, Your Excellency, we're still here. We didn't go anywhere but downtown, that's all. We haven't gone anywhere. We didn't die. We didn't all go stone crazy. We didn't commit suicide. We didn't all drink ourselves to death. Not all of us became intoxicated with drugs and things like that, no. And not all of us succumbed to that stereotype that they shaped and formed about us. Not all of us believed what they said about us, no. Some of us took the option to believe differently about ourselves. And Mr. de Tocqueville, we're still here.
Any of you may remember that some years ago, the R&B artist-composer Smokey Robinson recorded a song about the tears of a clown. How many of you remember that? It's like the tears of a clown when there's no one around. In the second verse of that song, Smokey Robinson makes reference to this aria when he talks about some of the very same things that Dr. Barton has spoken of. He says, I'm going to do just like Payachi did. I'm going to keep on smiling in spite of my tears. I'm going to laugh even though my heart is breaking. So you might want to think of this as sort of an Italian version of the Smokey Robinson hit, The Tears of a Clown.
Brothers and sisters, if there's anybody here today who feels like giving up, I want to stop you in your tracks and tell you that, oh, it may be rough now, but remember, a big shot is nothing but a little shot that kept on shooting. You got to remember that. You got to remember that. And furthermore, even if you do not have many, many words, try to remember the words of this little Native American boy who was brought up on a mission station, and they had a closing ceremony, but his language was very limited, and they said, nevertheless, we want you now to give a poem for your graduation. And he had not learned much of the English language, having spoken his native language, but he put a poem together, which I want to give to you as you enter into this first stage of your struggle. No matter how limited you may be, try to remember this little boy who gave his poem, and the poem went like this. Go on, go on, go on. Go on, go on, go on. Go on, go on, go on, go on. Go on, go on, go on.
Can you explain what that project is about?
Oh, we're dealing with mental health disorders, and it's a class of like 20 kids, and we each divided into groups of four. And within those four groups, we all pick the mental health issue, and together, at the end, we put all our projects together and made one newsletter about various mm-hmm. types of mental health mm-hmm. issues. And at the end, we'll present it to some place in Manhattan.
Okay, would anyone else like to talk about their final project?
Kingsbrook's project is about diseases that affect people of color. And like some of these diseases are prostate cancer, skin cancer, asthma, diabetes, heart disease, sickle cell anemia. And we just try to put together those like pamphlets and hand out to everybody so they can have information on it so they don't be ignorant. You know, because a lot of people, they don't know enough about the diseases, so when, say, like some a loved one in their family gets it, they don't know how to comfort them, they don't know how to approach them or whatever, so they, I mean, you're just trying to open everybody's eyes. You know, just because you have a disease, that don't mean you're different. You can still be a regular person, just as you have something that's a little bit different from you. Might not be able to be cured.
Mm-hmm. Okay, anyone else before we move on? Okay, I just wanted to backtrack a bit. Earlier we talked about the fact that some of you were working in various job sites. You had mentors. I think a few people mentioned the fact that you had mentors. And I want to talk to you specifically about what exactly is a mentor and what does the mentor do.
that.
Okay.
Well, a mentor, did the person mold you into the setting you in, like the job setting? He'll like train you and make you know your task for the summer. And then you work from there. You work side by side with the mentor. And then he teach you what you need to know. And from 9 o'clock, what you will be doing until it's time for you to go home.
Okay.
A mentor is somebody that teaches you, tells you what's right and wrong. You know, might teach you easy way to do things instead of doing it the hard way. And just helping you along through your job. And just like being a parent for you. Okay.
Is there anyone here who has developed a special relationship with their mentor that they might want to talk about? Mandy?
My mentor, well, last year I was in the program, and like, she wanted to know, she was concerned about my future. She wanted to know what I wanted to become. I told her a registered nurse or physician assistant. So she really wanted me to like be something in like the blood bank, but that's what I wanted to be. So she was understanding, and she was helpful to give me pamphlets on colleges like St. Joe's College.
Okay. Anyone else? Okay, Persia.
My mentor, she's like my mother. She knows my mother, so I know I can't play around on the job. But she's like my mother to me. She tells me, you know, you have to watch out for this person. You know, be careful what you say, what you do, and everything like that. She doesn't just tell me, just, you know, why are you doing that? Why, you know, she really steers me in the right direction.
Mm-hmm. The mentor that I was assigned to is not really a mentor to me, but it's another physical therapist that's there by the name of Jeannie. I really stick next to her because she tells me most of the stuff to do, how to do it, how to work with the patients and all that. I think she's really my mentor, not the one I was assigned to. So I feel closer to her than my assigned mentor.
Okay. All right, also I understand, you mentioned that the person that you were assigned to is not the person who has actually been mentoring you. Do we pick our mentors? Do you think we pick our mentors, or how does mentoring, the whole mentoring process work in your estimation? Brandon?
That it happens when the person that you're at your site, they pick you and they take on them when they see you trying hard, and they want to show you certain things. They see that you have an inquisitive mind, you want to know, and your mentor is not showing you the right way, or they're there more times than your mentor is, and they show you really what to do, and they put you under their wing. Like mm-hmm. My mentor, she's not nice, and I have another one, he's there, his name, we call him Reverend, because he's a reverend in our church, mm-hmm. And he's really nice and cool, and sometimes we talk about Bibles, stuff, mm-hmm. Even though it shows me how to do the building and how to break down certain things.
Mm-hmm. So he teaches you much more beyond your actual job duties and responsibilities. You learn a lot of other things from this person. So anyone really can be your mentor, your teacher. I understand the elevator man is your mentor. Rondell, do you want to talk about that?
Well, I was assigned to a mentor, right? But she wasn't really a mentor. She just had me running around doing stuff. I didn't even know what I was supposed to do. But he showed me and he molded me into who I am now in the hospital, you know. I'm known to be very successful in the Brookfield Hospital, if you ask anybody. But mm-hmm. He showed me a lot, you know what I mean? So I'm just glad for that. I'm thankful. Cosmo, oh yes, Cosmo, if you're watching, this must be.
Okay, I want to talk to you also about your program in relationship to other programs in the hospital.